everyone could please take your seats. We'll get started. All right. Welcome back. I hope you've enjoyed our luncheon this afternoon, as well as remarks by Ken Stiles and the insights he shared. For those of you joining us through YAF's virtual pass, thank you again for your participation. If you are participating on YouTube, please do sign up for our virtual pass at yaf.org/virtualpass. And we do have a social media contest going on as well. We'll have some great prizes for the students to enter. Just tweet hashtag YAFCon and tag at YAF. Now, as I shared earlier during Dr. Folsom's first session, part of our mission here at YAF is to train the next generation of leaders, all of you, to understand and advance free market principles at your schools after you graduate and into your professional careers. It's for this reason that we're glad Dr. Folsom is joining us for a second session at YAF's Reagan Ranch High School Conference. Dr. Folsom, again, as I shared earlier, is YAF's longest serving faculty member. He's spoken at a number of our conferences, including this one, our high school conference out in DC, and our National Conservative Student Conference, the premier conservative conference for college students around the country. He understands the virtue of free enterprise and the importance of teaching history the right way, considering the kind of history, unfortunately, that so many schools and courses teach around the country. Dr. Folsom has had a distinguished career teaching history at Hillsdale College, where he has educated countless classes of students and graduating classes of students on real history, not what is often presented in, as history in textbooks, and is a rewriting of history that seeks to divide us rather than unite us. This morning, Dr. Folsom spoke about the greatest period in American history and discussed the qualities that made great entrepreneurs during that time. For his second lecture, Dr. Folsom will be delivering a relatively new set of remarks. So that's very exciting for us, and I hope for you. But before I share a bit about his talk, I want to ask you a couple questions. How many of you learned something new from Dr. Folsom's first talk this morning? The entire room. That's great. And how many of you are excited to hear him again? All right.
I hope you're still feeling that way in 30 minutes. We'll see. But hey, I'm glad to be back. It was fun this morning. And I wanted to get into the second topic here today, which is that of textbook bias. Do you all have that sheet of paper in front of you, or the six passages from a leading American history textbook? We're going to go over some of those. I hope all of them. The textbook is, you all have that? Everybody? Raise your hand if you have that piece of paper. Everybody has it? Good. I have it started. Textbook bias lecture. Textbooks are important because they run the class. And they have this aura of authenticity. And often students think, well, if these professors say that and they're experts, then it must be so. And the problem is that textbooks are deeply flawed, U.S. history textbooks, except for Larry Schweikart's textbook, Patriots History of the United States. Textbooks are deeply troubled. And that's what I want to get into, because a lot of you have had U.S. history, and some of you are going to have it, and many of you will have it in college. And I wanted to go through just to look and see how sometimes historians will distort the truth and talk about that a little bit. The textbook I had in mind, some of you may know it, it's called The American Pageant by David Kennedy and Elizabeth Cohen, and it's gone through dozens, really 16 editions. How many are familiar with that textbook? Oh my goodness, I didn't think there would be that. I thought maybe two or three. Looks like at least a dozen of you. Have you used it in your classes already? Some of you are going to have it next year because it's the most popular U.S. history text, especially for AP history. It dominates the field. And so I wanted to go through this text because it's very biased. The authors both, Cohen teaches at Harvard. David Kennedy teaches at Stanford and has won a Pulitzer Prize. So you would think that they would know better than to make some of the errors that they make. But I want to go through this because a lot of these biases you will see in history textbooks. Let me start. The first two I have in here intentionally because they're connected with what I said this morning. And I want you to look at that. In fact, I'd like people to come up early to the microphone and tell me what you think might be wrong with the first two. The first one is transcontinental railroad building was so costly and risky as to require government subsidies. By the way, this textbook is sold, it's hard to tell, but at least 5 million copies. It has been used since 1956 was the first edition. Generations of people have been educated on this textbook. Okay, the first one, transcontinental railroad building was so costly and risky as to require government subsidies. And the second one there is on John D. Rockefeller. We talked about the transcontinentals in the first talk, the Union Pacific and the Central Pacific. And the second is, let us pray was said to be Rockefeller's unwritten motto, P-R-E-Y. Yeah, let us pray. Ruthlessly wielding vast power, Standard Oil, which was Rockefeller's company, soon cornered the entire world petroleum market. Wow. Can I have somebody come up and talk about either one of those? Yeah, go ahead to the the microphone isn't up. I was hoping somebody would come up. Nobody came up, and that's because we don't have a microphone. Well, no wonder you didn't come up. Now we have a microphone, and I see a couple students are coming up. Thank you for coming up, and I'd like to hear. Yeah, the first one, transcontinental railroad building was so costly and risky as to require government subsidies, and the second on John D. Rockefeller. Yeah, go ahead.
So the first one, when it came to the railroad, it's almost worded as if the entire project was almost a necessity for the country. That it was almost essential for the government, for the U.S. economy to have a railroad going from the west to the east coast.
Okay. That gets us started. Does somebody else? There's some more things. Or go ahead.
Mine was about the second one, about Rockefeller.
Okay.
Because I love Rockefeller, so.
Okay.
He was a pretty religious man, so I could easily see them misquoting it and saying, let us pray, meaning let us pray.
Us attack.
But I could also understand that he seemed very aggressive in what I've read. He could come across that way, but he was really a really nice guy. So I could see him maybe saying that like one time, and then everyone be like, oh, that was his motto. He said that a lot. I'm sure he did. He said it one time in one interview, I'm sure. And that's kind of how I'm interpreting what they have written.
Well, how about this? He never said it. He said it zero times. But look at how the wording is clever. Let us pray was said to be Rockefeller's unwritten motto. He never said it. But do you see that? It was said. Notice the use of what in English, the passive voice, was said. They don't directly say who said it. But it's like people said that was his unwritten motto, and he never said it. Now that's interesting. The second part, ruthlessly wielding vast power, Standard Oil soon cornered the entire world petroleum market. In a market economy, it's very hard to control the whole market. Rockefeller controlled a large portion of the market by charging 8 cents a gallon for his kerosene. 8 cents a gallon. Nobody else could really compete very well with him, although in the United States alone, there were more than 60 other companies producing kerosene. It's a market economy. In the world, the Russians were producing and selling oil. In other words, there was a worldwide competitive market, But Rockefeller was able to produce oil cheaper than most of the others, and so he had about a 50% share of the whole world market. But look at what, by the way, and people bought that because they liked his kerosene. They could have bought the Russian kerosene or one of the other 60 companies in the United States, but they bought Rockefeller's because it was high quality, it was reliable, and it was cheap. But look at the statement, "Let us pray," was said to be Rockefeller's unwritten motto. Ruthlessly wielding vast power, Standard Oil soon cornered the entire world market. It's, in other words, not only is the first part false, the second part is false. And I know some of you may be thinking, well, how would we as students realize that? And I know that because I faced the same problem. I would see these things in the textbook and I'd say, boy, this just looks terrible. But I don't know what to say. There's a logic here. First, the first point is to just ask a professor, who said that? Let us pray. Did Rockefeller say that? Since he never said it, the professor is on the spot. And that reveals the bias right there in the opening part. Secondly, how do you wield vast power and control the world market unless you are the best in a market economy? Now, if it were a government-run economy, you could be the worst, and you're the only one around because the government won't let any competitors be in the market. But if you're in a free market economy and you control a huge amount, the one thing we know for sure is you are good at what you do. People are voluntarily coming and buying your product because they think it's the best compared with the other alternatives. In this case, half the world bought somebody else's oil, but half bought Rockefeller's. 50% American market share enabled him to be the first billionaire in U.S. history, Henry Ford being second. He also was a good environmentalist because the other oil producers would dump the parts that they couldn't use into the ground and just leave it there, or into the Cuyahoga River near Cleveland, which is where Rockefeller's first headquarters was. Rockefeller did it this way, because remember, he's a Christian. Hence the "let us pray" that they use on him there. And Rockefeller said, God doesn't make junk. So everything that God put into oil has to have a use. We just don't know what it is yet. And so he hired chemists. He was the first guy to do serious research and development, R&D that we call it. And he had his chemists and he said, he was a very soft-spoken man. There is a use for all of these products in this barrel of oil. We just don't know what they are yet. We can do the gasoline and the kerosene, but there's these other parts of it we don't know. Why don't you go and find out for us? And so the chemists would work, and they produced waxes like candle wax, Vaseline, paint, all sorts of byproducts, and then Rockefeller sold the byproducts. He would even take the oil that people wanted to dump in on the ground and say, I'll take it off your hands, please don't dump it. That's why I think Rockefeller is the first great environmentalist. Why don't we have some other comments, though? I hope you see that helps. Yes, a comment, because we haven't touched on the first one.
Yeah, because I know this morning you talked about how government subsidies were the problem in actuality. When the government was subsidizing, then they would just utilize that. When you said it was by the mile, then they would just build those crazy, like, and stuff instead of actually being, like, an efficient
way. Right.
And then when you don't subsidize, then they got absolutely $0 in subsidies, then they would have, like, a really correct, direct one. So in actuality, it wasn't so costly and risky as to require. It was actually, as you said, Abraham Lincoln just said, I'll give you as much as you want. So it wasn't that they were requiring the subsidies. And in actuality, the government intervention and having the government have an active role was actually making it less efficient, the transcontinental railroad.
I can't improve upon what you just said there. Excellent. Three transcontinental railroads had subsidies, and they all went broke in the recession of 1893. James J. Hill built his privately, and his made a profit during the recession. Does that suggest that transcontinental railroad building was so risky and costly as to require government subsidies, when the ones who had the subsidies were outperformed by the one who didn't have the subsidies? It's very interesting, though, how the mindset of the progressive historian is, if government is in it, it works better. And that is so pervasive that it even infected the mind of these of this Harvard professor and this Stanford professor who won a Pulitzer Prize. It's hard, the question of did they knowingly make a falsehood, I'm not sure. But their progressive mindset that government makes things work better led them down the path where a falsehood was stated. Now, in the book I gave you, The Myth of the Robber Barons, I have a chapter on James J. Hill and a chapter on Rockefeller. Young America's Foundation had me write this book 30 years ago because this was so common in the textbooks. The sad news is, even after writing this, the errors are still there. But now you have some ammunition to deal with them. So, yeah, do we have another comment? Go ahead.
Yes, I noticed it seems like the person who wrote it seems very biased against Rockefeller in that he says pray, which is aggressive, but also the wording of ruthlessly and also cornered. It's just much more aggressive than how you said he's a more calm and gentle person.
Very good point. The wording is often a tip-off. Aggressive wording like that is distorting and making him look bad. To read that sentence, even if you didn't know anything about Rockefeller, you'd say, gee, this textbook writer hates Rockefeller. That's a good point. Yeah. Well, let's go to the third one. Those are two, and I hope those help. The third one is going to be, we're going to turn our attention to the New Deal. How many of you, in the 1930s, in the Great Depression, we're going to talk about Franklin Roosevelt. Let me read this first one. Great crises, this is your textbook, the third item. Great crises often call forth gifted leaders, and the hand of destiny tapped Franklin Roosevelt on the shoulder. That's a little bit different tone from Rockefeller, isn't it? Right. How many of you had teachers thus far in your education? When Roosevelt has come up, and maybe some of you have not had comments on Roosevelt from the classroom, but he's a very popular figure to talk about in American history, and he's often discussed. How many have had discussions on Roosevelt in your from your let's put it this way, from your teachers that are favorable to Roosevelt? Oh my goodness, it's huge. Look at that. Just look around the room. How many have had comments from your teachers that are critical of Franklin Roosevelt? A few. Great. How many of you are homeschooled? Maybe the same ones. But I'm glad there are a few who have had teaching that is critical. But I'd have to say this, by about a 5-to-1 margin, most of you have had teaching that's complimentary to Roosevelt, and partly that's by the textbook. This is a typical textbook comment on Roosevelt. Great crises often call forth gifted leaders and the hand of destiny. It was the hand of destiny tapped Franklin Roosevelt on the shoulder. Okay. Well, here's part of the problem. Unemployment was at double digits under the first two terms of Roosevelt until World War II. His unemployment rate always ranged in the United States from 15 to 25%. It was always in there somewhere, an average of about 20% unemployment. The worst sustained 8-year period in American history by a long shot. Nothing is even close. The debt that we had, because we had massive federal spending, the massive federal spending, as I'm going to suggest here, made it worse. It didn't improve it, it made it worse. But we doubled the entire national debt. When Roosevelt became president, our national debt was about $18 billion. It was about $40 billion after the end of his second term. It doubled. The national debt doubled. In other words, what I'm telling you is we averaged 20% unemployment and we doubled the national debt while doing so. The hand of destiny was a little bit misguided, perhaps, when it tapped Roosevelt. I wanted to read a passage because I wrote a book, New Deal or Raw Deal, because the distortions on Roosevelt were so severe. we had the major presidential poll conducted by Arthur Schlesinger Jr. And according to the Schlesinger poll, Franklin Roosevelt and Abraham Lincoln were the top two presidents in U.S. history, ahead of George Washington. And I thought, my job is cut out for me. I have to write a book on Roosevelt to try to explain this. And I decided to begin the book with this quotation from his best friend, the Secretary of Treasury, Henry Morgenthau. Roosevelt appointed a good friend, Henry Morgenthau, to be Secretary of Treasury because he wanted one of his people on the money. Morgenthau, however, was so frustrated by all this spending and all this high unemployment that he finally, at the end of his second term, made this statement. Unemployment was 20.6%, and this was in 1939, and he said, Morgenthau said, "We have tried spending money. We are spending more than we have ever spent before, and it does not work. And I have just one interest, and if I am wrong, somebody else can have my job. I want to see this country prosperous. I want to see people get a job. I want to see people get enough to eat. We have never made good on our promises." And then he concludes with this sentence. "I say after 8 years of the Roosevelt administration, we have just as much unemployment as when we started, and an enormous debt to boot." So the question then is, how can we have double the national debt, make no improvement, and have sustained high unemployment? I want to answer that, but I also want to point out, when you have this kind of thing, it has bad social consequences. For example, the divorce rate increased. This was the only 8-year period since we've been keeping records that life expectancy did not increase. It actually went down. Life expectancy, when Roosevelt was elected, was 62 years. And it dropped a little bit below that in the next 8 years. If you look at this, it's unusual because in the previous 32 years before Roosevelt was elected, life expectancy increased 15 years, from 47 to 62. And then it flattened out and actually went down in the next 8, and then it went back up again. The hand of destiny chokes some people or something like that, because the death rate goes up. It's a nasty hand of destiny, isn't it? What I want to do in the next 2 is look at some of these programs. The 2 big ones, some of you may have heard of it, the WPA, which is Works Progress Administration. Have some of you heard of that? Road builders, they did a lot of, hey, we have unemployed people, let's put them to work building roads. And doing other things, but road building was a main part. And the first one here, though, is on the AAA, the Agricultural Adjustment Act. Farmers, and I read this one, it's the 4th one. The AAA, or the Agricultural Adjustment Act, would eliminate price-depressing surpluses by paying growers to reduce their crop acreage. Ponder this for a minute. We are going to improve the condition of the farmer who is getting low prices for his crops by paying him not to produce on up to 1/4 of his land. So if he has, say, a 320-acre farm, we will pay him 10 acres. And the amount we will pay him is almost the same as the average annual income for an American at the time. It isn't quite there, but it's close to it. We're going to pay somebody not to produce. How many of you would like to be paid not to produce homework? Maybe I can get paid to stop my lecture and just go. I'm getting signals from the back that I can't do that, see? So when you think about it, paying somebody not to work, is that really going to get us out of a Great Depression? There are 2 problems that are created. One, of course, is that you're having to get tax revenue. And to pay somebody not to produce means we have to get the money somewhere, which means people who aren't farmers are being taxed and their money is being taken so that we can give it to farmers not to grow their crops. That means that the people who had money that just had it taken to give to the farmers, they can no longer buy a suit of clothes, a tie, all of these things that might have helped grow the economy. All of that is not there because it's taken by the government to give to farmers not to grow anything. The second thing that was wild about this, and I get into this in my book, is once you've paid farmers not to produce, for the first time, virtually the first time in U.S. history, the United States, because we had so little production, see, because farmers are being paid not to produce, so the wheat crop and the corn crop and the cotton crop are no longer very big. In fact, we had shortages, and now we're going to have to buy imports from other countries. You won't hear it very often, but in 1935, after the AAA had been passed, we imported 13 million bushels of wheat. We're usually a wheat exporting nation. We used to export a large percentage of our crop. Now we're importing 13 million bushels. We imported 34,809,000 bushels of corn. Right? Because we're paying farmers not to grow corn. So now we don't have corn, so now we're having to pay to bring it in from outside. We also, the cotton crop is an enormous factor in the South, and we paid farmers not to produce cotton, so in 1935 we imported 36 million pounds of cotton. All of those products we used to export. But we're paying farmers not to produce them, so now we have to pay for expensive imports to substitute for the crops that weren't grown because we paid the farmers not to produce them. And now we're paying foreigners to send them to the United States. Does it surprise you that that didn't get us out of the Great Depression? The interesting thing is this whole passage, you will not hear very much criticism, if any, of the AAA. And as you know, it's not that the textbook writers aren't capable of criticizing. Look what they did to Rockefeller. But the AAA, he was trying. Roosevelt was trying, see? He was experimenting. He was trying. But it would be like if you cut your arm accidentally and were going out and you said, does somebody have a Band-Aid? If somebody amputated your arm, would you say, well, he was trying? Well, Roosevelt sort of amputated a lot of the crops. At least they never got grown. And so we have to buy the imports. And so that is part of the reason that was such an unsuccessful program. Now, I know some of you are thinking, well, if a program that's so dumb to pay people not to grow, how could that be sustained? The Republican candidate for president was running against Roosevelt in 1936. He was the governor of Kansas. His last name was Landon. And he said, that is stupid to pay people not to produce. And the people of Kansas said, we like our subsidies. Are you going to take them from us? See, this is your typical Republican deer in headlights. You love what he said. He said, no, I won't take your subsidy from you. Because, see, they were ready to vote against him if he took away being paid not to produce. We want to continue to be paid not to produce. And he said, I'll just run it better than Franklin Roosevelt. Are you going to vote for somebody who gave you your subsidy or somebody who says, oh, I'll do it even better than he did? Well, let's put it this way. In 1936, he did not carry his own home state of Kansas. In fact, he only carried two states in the entire nation, Maine and Vermont. He got 8 electoral votes, and Roosevelt got 523. The lesson that was learned from this is, if we promise people stuff, even if it's stupid, they'll get the stuff and they'll vote for me. And even though the economy doesn't recover, I stay in office. Well, the AAA, I have the quote here because I thought you might like to see the program somewhat explained, and I wanted to talk about it a little bit. Here's the other one, the WPA. It's the fifth on next to last. And I need to explain the WPA first. It's a road building program. So they're going to build some roads. Now, it makes sense if you think about it in theory. At least it makes better, more logical sense than the AAA, the agriculture. We're going to pay people, but this time we're not paying them not to build roads. We're paying them to build roads. And since they're unemployed, isn't this good? Because it gives them employment. There are two things to look at. The first is back to this business of the tax dollars. If you get money from people who could be buying stuff, instead it's going into a fund to have these people build the roads. Well, you say maybe that's a good thing to build the roads. But what I did in my book was I decided to sort of look at the WPA and look at some of the what people were saying, how the Democrats were running the WPA. This will give you a clue as to what the problem is. V.G. Copeland, the Democratic chairman of the state of Indiana, explained his opinion on the WPA clearly. Quote, "What I think will help is to change the WPA management from top to bottom. Put men in there who are in favor of using these Democratic projects to make votes for the Democratic Party." Aha. In other words, the WPA is going to be used to make votes for the Democratic Party. The James Doherty, a New Hampshire Democrat, agreed. Quote, here's another Democrat. "It is my personal belief that to the victor belong the spoils, and the Democrats should be holding most of these WPA positions so that we might strengthen our fences for the 1940 election." In other words, the WPA is going to be a vote-getting organization. This was explained, and I also talk about this a little bit in the book, by a fellow by the name of Frank Kent. And Frank Kent made this statement. He was a newspaper writer for the Baltimore Sun. And he saw the WPA, and he made this statement here, if I can find it. Here it is. "Every city and every state needs its portion of this incredibly great sum. It's the biggest federally funded program in U.S. history up to that time, the WPA to build roads." He says, "Every city and every state needs its portion of this incredibly great sum. They all want as much as they can get. Failure to secure its proportion places a state at a great disadvantage. That means the state must tax heavier locally. Thus, the mayors and governors are obliged to woo Mr. Roosevelt. Roosevelt has the money, and they must have the money." So Roosevelt and his WPA director, Harry Hopkins, if you wanted some of that money, you had to come to Washington and explain to Roosevelt why you ought to get some of that money. We discover from that the people who made the best case and got the most money were those who said, "I will use this to help strengthen the Democratic Party in our state." And Roosevelt said, "Good, then we can win the next election." And he beat Landon, as I say, in the Electoral College, 523-8. In those elections, Roosevelt and the other candidates highlighted all the WPA money that was brought into every state. And in their advertisements, they said, "If the Republicans are elected, this wealth of money coming into your state may stop." And thus, the idea was, we're going to have to vote Democrat. I have a variety of people who said, "I said I was a Republican and they wouldn't give me a WPA job." A man named Thomas Stokes was a newspaper man and said, "I like the WPA, I can't believe it's this corrupt." He investigated it, it was that corrupt. This was in the day when the news media, although it tended to be liberal, was honest and had some integrity. And so what happened is, Thomas Stokes, for his exposing the WPA as a political racket, won a Pulitzer Prize. The WPA eventually, when the Republicans got control of Congress, they were able to abolish it. But until then, the Democrats were using it to give to Democrats. And by the way, October, the month before the election, WPA people didn't build roads. They distributed campaign literature for the Democratic Party. So in other words, you're being paid by the government to distribute campaign literature for the Democratic Party. That's what Thomas Stokes found and won his Pulitzer Prize that he thought was so shocking. In any case, I say that about the WPA to get us to our point on the quote, because they actually do kind of admit that there might have been a problem or two with the WPA. Look at this quote. Not every WPA project strengthened the infrastructure. For instance, one controlled crickets in Wyoming, while another built a monkey pen in Oklahoma City. By the way, there are a whole bunch of these. One fellow was counting caterpillars. That was his job on the WPA. Predictably, missions like these caused critics to sneer that WPA meant we provide alms. But the fact is that over a period of 8 years, nearly 9 million people were given jobs, not handouts. In other words, they come down in support of that. I just want to make one more point. You think, well, what about handouts? People are hungry. The Democratic Party had an answer for this. In the relief money that was given for handouts, the state of Illinois ended up with 20% of the first batch of relief money. They got more money than Texas, California, and New York. Texas, California, and New York got less combined than the state of Illinois. Illinois was a swing state. They had political influence, and the relief money, just like the WPA money, all went to that state. Massachusetts, the city of Boston, they got zero. So in other words, the people in Massachusetts in the first wave of expense for money for relief, they had to support their own relief, plus they had to send money to Illinois for Illinois' relief. So the money that is given out, the taxpayer money, whether it's to the WPA or whether it is to relief, what they called relief or welfare, all has to be filtered politically. And when it's filtered politically, it went through the Democratic Party. And that explains, see, I'm having to explain, how does Roosevelt, with 18 and 20% unemployment, win re-election with 523 electoral votes to 8 for the Republicans? We have the highest rate of unemployment of anybody running for re-election. How can he win like that? Hoover, I guess, had high rate of unemployment running against Roosevelt. But it's unprecedented that somebody would win big and have a high rate of unemployment. And part of the explanation is because of the political filter, all that money goes in there. Any comments or questions on the WPA? When I'm done, come on up. I'd like to hear that because some of you may have some. Hold that, and I'll finish this last one, and we'll open it up to questions. The last one, one striking feature of the 1932 election was the beginning of a distinct shift of blacks. Beginning with the election of 1932, they became notably, in the great urban centers of the North, a vital element of the Democratic Party. In other words, the blacks were Republicans and now they're going to become Democrats. This comment is technically incorrect, but it is correct in the general direction that it heads. One reason, the 1932 election, when Roosevelt first ran and was elected, the black vote was 3-1 for Herbert Hoover. In other words, the statement is false. But it's generally true in that by 1936, the blacks were 3-1 for Roosevelt. So it points in the right direction, even though it's technically false. I'm not sure why they chose to make a misstatement. It may be because the hand of destiny was on Franklin Roosevelt, and they felt it would be good to say blacks were following the hand of destiny and voting for him. Once you realize that the black vote did not become Democrat until 1934 and 1936, you realize why they were becoming Democrat, and that is that Roosevelt was targeting blacks for special subsidies. he had gifts to various black groups who were part of some of his, like the WPA, the CCC, the AAA. Blacks were able to get some money from that. But also they were targeted. Howard University in Washington, D.C. received a huge federal subsidy right before the 1936 election. And Roosevelt's cabinet official in charge of the subsidy went on national radio to advertise it. And I've done work in the National Archives and the Library of Congress. And you can see the letters coming in to them saying, ah, that radio address really helped us with the black community in our state. In other words, the idea we can get a subsidy from Roosevelt swung the traditional alliance, which was strongly Republican before that. I don't know if some of you know this, but in the 1800s after the Civil War, 20 Republicans were elected to the House of Representatives. 20 black people were elected to the House of Representatives, to Congress. All 20 were Republicans. Two U.S. senators were elected to the House of, elected to the U.S. Senate, who are black. Both Republicans. And even when we get into the next century, the first black elected in the 1900s to Congress, a Republican, Roosevelt opposed him. He was in office. And Roosevelt in Chicago, he was in the city of Chicago, had another black candidate to try to replace him, and they knocked him out because the black Republican did not go along with the subsidies. And so the black Democrat said, I will come in with subsidies, and he overthrew and became the first Democrat, black, ever to be elected in U.S. history. The blacks had a long, the Democrats had a long alliance against black Americans, African Americans. The blacks founded Democrats founded the Ku Klux Klan. Nathan Bedford Forrest was a delegate to the 1868 Democratic Convention. He founded the Ku Klux Klan. Franklin Roosevelt appointed as his first justice of the Supreme Court Hugo Black, who was a leader of the Ku Klux Klan in the state of Alabama. And that was his first appointee to the U.S. Supreme Court. Even as recently as 2010, the senator with the most seniority in the U.S. Senate was a Senator Byrd from West Virginia, B-Y-R-D. Senator Byrd was in the Senate for 52 years. He died in around 1910. He was first elected in 1958. He died in 2010. He was first elected in 1958, so he's in, I guess, 52 years. And he was a member of the Ku Klux Klan. It was almost strictly affiliated with the Democratic Party. I thought it was interesting that when he died, Bill and Hillary Clinton stood up for him. And Bill Clinton said, oh, he's a wonderful guy. He was just in the Klan because it would win him some votes. And I thought, well, what about the guy who was not elected? Who wasn't in the Klan? Maybe he should have gotten the election. But that was Bill Clinton's defense. So that the Democratic Party today is not affiliated with the Ku Klux Klan, but it has, for a long time, it had a long affiliation with the Ku Klux Klan, and it's been only recently that those people have departed who were prominent in the Ku Klux Klan. So what I'm saying is it's not unusual that black Americans voted Republican. The switch was in 1936. Let me make one more comment, and then we can go up and have questions. The poor guy who lost Governor Landon of Kansas, he was the one who saw this happen to him. And he had hoped to get the black vote, and he made this statement. The Democrats are using the relief rolls as modern reservations on which the great colored race is to be confined forever as a ward of the federal government. That was his statement in defeat in 1936. President Trump today is hoping to counteract this by having his tax cuts have produced an increase in employment. The black unemployment rate is lower now than it has been in decades. And sometimes, this is just to make the connection, you will hear President Trump openly recruit the black vote. His position is most blacks would like to get off the reservation and come in and have good jobs. And that's how he wants to recruit black Americans to the Republican Party. Well, I'll tell you what, let's have some comments. Thank you. I hope this helped. Before I get into comments, one thing, the rise of the United States in the late 1800s to being a world power is important because you see free markets at work. The Great Depression in the 1930s is an important period to study because big government increases in a huge way, and we see bad results, but we see the textbook authors defend those results and say it actually was a good thing. Those are sort of the main points I wanted to get in these quotations from the textbook. By the way, this part at the beginning where I have that website, www.education-research.org/pageant/, I did a line-by-line critique of a lot of this textbook, and it's on that website. If you are using this textbook, you can look on that website, and I have Kennedy and Cohen American Pageant book on the page numbers, and I have the quotations, and I have the comments on those page numbers to help students who may be using this book to try to get through the biases. Go ahead, let's have some questions.
Question is from Katie from Woodrow Wilson Classical High School, who is attending online. And she said, do you think that Common Core has led to an increase in biased textbooks and generally biased classrooms?
It's too early to tell. I can't tell yet. I have not seen the specific Common Core textbooks and studied them in a way that I can answer that. But I can say that it appears from comments that I'm getting that it's not helping the situation. And by the way, you heard that, it's Woodrow Wilson High School. Woodrow Wilson was a Democrat, and when he came in to be president, he threw out a lot of blacks in the federal bureaucracy. He downsized the number of blacks, and he allowed the putting up of screens in federal offices so white people would not have to look at black people. Black people would have to be behind the screens. And that's why that blacks voted so heavily Republican up until the time of Franklin Roosevelt, because they flat out did not want that. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Blake Zara. I go to Thousand Oaks High School, and my A-Push class uses the American Pageant book. And
oh, okay.
Yeah, so when we spent almost an entire week on all of Roosevelt's acts for like the Great Society, and the AAA Act actually came up a lot, and my teacher, and I'm pretty sure the book also said that the AAA was meant to regulate the cost of the wheat, so then it wouldn't, because
yes,
the demand was so low and the supply would have been so high if they kept producing the same amount of wheat, so they gave them the subsidy so then it could kind of level out the price of the wheat. But that doesn't really make sense if they end up importing the wheat after the fact.
That's right. We're having to import, and you're right. Another feature of the AAA was that they regulated on many crops, not all of them, but on many of them, the price. And what this did, prices that were set too high, farmers shifted into those crops, so we had shortages in the crops that weren't subsidized. In other words, that produced disaster as well. How did your discussion go? Was your teacher pretty fair on the AAA, or was it?
My teacher's, he calls himself a fiscally conservative guy, but I'm pretty sure he's just a straight liberal, because whenever we talk about anything that has to do with workers' unions or anything with the monopolies, he's like, he takes them extremely liberally, and is extremely for like the workers and the lower class of the Gilded Age.
Oh, so he favored the unions and all
yes.
of that. I had a quote here that I think I have here to read. Here's a quote from the leading labor union, the American Federation of Labor, and it's Samuel Gompers. Keep in mind, Henry Ford and John D. Rockefeller were hiring blacks and we're trying to help them. Here's the leader of the leading American labor union. Quote, the Caucasians are not gonna let their standard of living be destroyed by Negroes, Chinamen, Japs, or any others. So the entrepreneurs were hiring black Americans and the labor union was trying to restrict their entry, most labor unions, not all, but many unions were trying to restrict entry of black Americans.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. My name is Stephen Albert. I go to Upland High School, and you brought up the WPA.
Yes.
Do you as well see something similar happening with the road construction crews in California?
I'm not sure what's happening. Explain that. What's happening? Do we have some kind of equivalent of WPA projects going on here in California?
A similar thing. It's unnecessary work, especially towards roads. They build lots and lots of islands and have yet to repair potholes all over them.
It could be because you may have something there, and I don't know enough to be able to offer a comment on that, except to say that sounds like a typical WPA project, because people are hired because of their political value, not because they're good at doing something. So often when you get WPA type of projects, not all of them were bad, but most of them were. And what you have is often people being hired and then not much good work being done, so that you have potholes, but you have a lot of money flowing out, but that gives votes for the party that is subsidizing the road workers. So that could be what's happening in California.
Thank you.
Sure.